Good morning, lovely people. Let's stand and worship. Actually, let's pray. Let's do that. Let's pray first. Let's shake this off. All right, Jesus, just want to pray a blessing on the congregation, God. Just want to pray that we will have our eyes set and fixed on you this morning as we worship you, God, and we will have just a clear heart and mind from whatever is maybe bogging us down, God, whatever's going on in our lives, God, will maybe just be put on hold for a minute as we completely worship you and surrender ourselves to you, God, and let you change us, because that's what worship is. It's cleansing and it's healing. Amen?
Amen.
So let's stand and let's worship together. So give thanks to the Lord. Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. So sing praise. Sing praise. With a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, his love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, his love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Sing it out, sing praise, sing praise to Jesus. Setting sun, his love endures forever, and by the grace of God we will carry on. His love endures forever. So sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Sing it out, sing praise, sing praise. Sing it out. His love endures forever. His love endures forever. His love endures forever. How long? His love endures forever. Sing it out. His love endures forever. So sing praise and sing praise. Us forever.
Lord of heaven.
I do not deserve
the grace that you have given, or the promise of your word. Lord, I stand in wonder at the sacrifice you made. With mercy beyond measure, my heart did you freely pay. Your love is deeper than any ocean, higher than the heavens reaches, beyond the stars in the sky. Jesus, your love has no bounds. Jesus, your love has no bounds. And Jesus, Lord of heaven,
I do not deserve.
I do not deserve,
yeah, the grace.
Praise that you have given, or the promise of your word. So Lord, Lord, I stand in wonder at the sacrifice you made. With mercy beyond measure,
Jesus, that your love has no bounds, God, and that you've removed our sins as far as the east is from the west. God, you're just limitless, and we're limited, God, so help us to lean on your strength, Help us to understand that, God, that you have something that we don't have. Imagine that. God, that us humans actually aren't invincible and we actually can't do anything without you. It's so easy to believe the lies, but God, you are so strong and so powerful. So help us to cling to your truth and your promises. Amen. Let's take this time now to greet each other in the name of the Lord.
Good morning, Calvary Chapel, Roseville. How are we doing today? I always ask that, and I don't get many responses. I'm fine. I'm the best. See, my class over here, they're talking. Anything else? Everybody doing good? Gather our stuff here. So good morning, welcome to Calvary Chapel. Like I said, if you are new to Calvary Chapel Roseville, we are delighted that you're here. We have these blue cards we'd love for you to fill out. They're on the back of the chairs there. It tells us a little about yourself. And they are good for one free item of your choice at the Solid Rock Cafe. And today we have, from our very own Greg Hall, banana cake with chocolate frosting. Yes, so if there was a holy union ever to be had, that's one. Love that combination. So that is back there. So let's go through a few of these. Baptism sign-ups. If any are interested in being baptized this summer, now is the time to do it. Summer is kind of getting too close to an end. Yeah, we're halfway through. The sign-up sheet is in the back in the foyer. So that is there for you. The Crochet Ministry is meeting. Next meeting is the 18th at 1 p.m. Continuing with the Crocodile Crochet Workshop. I have no idea what that is, but it sounds really cool. Contact Melanie. The Ladies' Breakfast is coming up on the 15th of August. Doors open at 9 a.m. Worship at 9:30. We have the Bible Bus every Wednesday coming up. The men's Bible study is not this Tuesday. It's the next. And then women's, I would assume, is starting up at some point when the summer's over. Food ministry continues to grow, and we are thanking everyone who is volunteering, and it's going really well, and it's continuing to grow. So we are also obviously thankful for those who are donating food and such, so it's doing really well. The Right Now Media signups are still there on the back table. Powerful tool for students and teachers of the Bible offered exclusively free to the church body, and the sign-up sheets are in the back, like I said. Let's see, Women's Retreat, obviously, is right around the corner. Please be in prayer for that, for the ladies attending, that they will be blessed, of course, and a safe travel there and back. Let's see, I think that was it. We can have the ushers come forward, unless I'm forgetting anything. Mortgage Building Fund is at 1253. And blessed are those who silence their cell phones, for they will be blessed, right? Thank you, Lord, again for bringing us all together. Father, we are honored to be here, and we thank you that you do not change, Father. Everything in this world is changing around us, but you and your word, they do not change, and we praise you for that. We ask you to bless these tithes and offering, use them for your glory and your holy name, we pray. Amen.
Praise the Lord and praise him for the congregation of the blessed family of God. Amen. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. I'm not hearing. Is it good to be in the house of the Lord? Thank you, Jesus. We're looking forward to what the Lord has for us this morning. He's already blessed us as we've come into his house. We're going to read Psalm 126, a song of ascents. When the Lord brought back the captivity of Zion, we were like those who dream. Then our mouth was filled with laughter and our tongue with singing. Then they said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us, and we are glad. Bring back our captivity, O Lord, as the streams in the south. Those who sow in tears shall reap in joy. He who continually goes forth weeping, bearing seed for sowing, shall doubtless come again with rejoicing, bringing his sheaves with him. Praise the Lord, he's coming back for us, amen. That psalm tells us that the Lord Jesus is going to return and for his people. The day is coming soon, isn't it? Pray for Israel, pray for the church. Pray that America will be broken, the church in America will be broken before the Lord, and turn our hearts back towards him, and he will heal our land if we repent. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Let's continue worshiping and celebrating what Jesus has done for us.
Quiet my soul, remember redemption's here, where your blood was spilled for my ransom. Everything I once held dear, I can't. You were to the cross where your love poured out.
Bring me to my knees.
Bring me to my knees. Lord, I lay me down. Rid me of myself. I belong to you. Oh, lead me. Lead me. Lead me to the cross where your love poured out.
Bring me to my knees.
Bring me to my knees. Lord, I lay me down. Rid me of myself. I belong to you. Oh, lead me. Lead me to the cross.
With our hands
singing a
hallelujah again.
We're singing hallelujah. We're singing hallelujah. We're singing hallelujah. We're singing for you. Yeah, we're waiting here for you with our hands lifted high in praise. And it's you, Jesus, and it's you we adore.
So bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing it like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. So bless the Lord, so bless the Lord, oh my soul. Soul, worship his holy name. Sing it out, sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship your holy name.
Because God, you're rich in love,
you're rich in love, and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find.
So bless the Lord,
so bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, oh my soul. Worship his holy name.
Let's sing it out.
your holy name.
Sing on that day.
And on that day, when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. So bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing it out. Sing like never.
Bless the Lord again.
So bless the Lord, oh my soul.
Oh my soul, I worship your holy name.
Sing it out.
And sing like never before. Oh my soul, I worship your holy name. Worship your holy name. Oh, worship your holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, worship your holy name. I will worship your holy name. I will worship your holy name.
Thank you, Jesus. God, as we direct this applause to you, God, we are so thankful for all that you've done and all that you are doing. God, because you were, you are, and you are to come. How do you wrap your head around that, God? I don't even think we're supposed to. God, I don't even think we're supposed to understand everything fully, God. But that's why we want to have a faith, God, and a trust and a hope in you that is so strong, God. So strong that other people are provoked to having what we have, God, and what we experience through you and your love, God, and your grace. We thank you, Jesus, so much for this worship time. And God, help these words to not just be something we sing to you, God, but to be something that we live by. Help these words to become our doctrine, Jesus. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Worship his holy name, God. Sing like never before, O my soul. I'll worship your holy name. Sing like never before. God, help us to sing that every single day. God, I'm guilty leaving it till Sunday. Let's sing that every single day to you, Jesus. Even if it's just spoken, even if it's just thought, even if it's prayed, God. Help us to be in constant prayer, God. You say to pray without ceasing, Jesus. Help us to understand what that means. To be worshiping you all of our days, God. We love you. We thank you for everyone in this building, God. We pray that everyone in this building is ministered to differently today. God, if they haven't already, that they pick up something that's just treasure. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen. Praise God. Lord, we give thanks to you this morning, and we just are so blessed to be here, Lord. And Father God, to be able to come and worship you, Lord. This morning in John chapter 10, we're going to look and see how the Israelites weren't able to do that freely, Lord. In fact, they were forced by law to worship Greek gods instead of Jehovah the Father. And Father, we give thanks this morning for worship, Lord. And no matter where you are on earth, which country, which prison cell, which mansion, wherever you are, a person can worship, Lord. Because it's something we can do without anything except being able to think and to pray and to worship and to connect with you. We pray in your name, Jesus, this morning. And everyone said, Amen. Good morning, one and all. How are you? Okay, very good. We have a, let's see what this is. Thank you. It's a thank you. Dear congregation, thank you so much for your prayers. I have had 4 good days. Your prayers are a blessing. Sincerely, Mary Hartwell. Wow, that's incredible. Last Sunday, do you remember we prayed for Mary? And Mary was really having a tough time, and she just wasn't having any quality time whatsoever because of her tent and the pain and the suffering that she was enduring. And we prayed that she would have some good days. And next thing you know, she's had good days. Incredible, awesome. That's prayer, the power of prayer. 4 good days when she wrote this. All right, now if you can't get to church, for some people that's no big deal. For other people, it's a real bummer. It's a real hindrance to life, to miss fellowship. And we encourage you to make it every week to church, to do what you can to sacrifice. You know, many people don't like getting up on Sunday morning to do anything. And many people don't like getting up on Sunday morning to go to church. But you have to fight the flesh, amen? And you've got to, you know, realize this morning, Tina, we were talking, and Tina said, yeah, sometimes I retreat. You know, I don't know, why am I going to the, we talked about it. And she goes to be a blessing. Huh? Come on. And she goes to be a blessing. She goes to be blessed. And that's what happens when we fellowship together. And that's why we need to be here. Not just to receive, you know, too many people, oh, I want to receive, oh, I hear the word, I worship and all this. But you also are to be here to the gathering of the brethren, to be a blessing, to bless other people. You know, it's not all about us. It's not all about me and what I get. And it's become too much like that. We get people calling up during the week and, oh, what does your church have to offer? You know, and what programs? You know, how much money do you give out for bills and whatnot and that type of thing? And, you know, what about, and then every so often someone comes and calls and says, they come in or they call and they say, well, what ministry opportunities do you have to serve at your church? And, you know, that's the way it should be. You know, you get blessed and you are a blessing. Now, what would Jesus do if he had a hard time getting to church? He'd walk, right? Yeah. And in Africa, when we go to Africa, there are people that walk 5 miles to get to church. And not one or two, but many. Many Africans, they walk 5 miles to get to church because there's no car, there's no bicycle, there's no nothing. Well, this morning, one of the brothers here rode a bicycle because he didn't have a ride. He rode a bicycle from Rancho Cordova to the church. Took about 2 hours. Now, you know, that's something, but Ed, can you please stand up? This is the brother, Ed Weathers. Oh, thank you, Ed. We're going to give Ed this award for putting the most effort into getting to church on Sunday. Usher, please. It's a What Would Jesus Do stone. Because he did what Jesus would do. He got himself to church. And if you have a pickup truck and you're going in that direction or you feel called to go in that direction, I think our brother Ed would probably really appreciate it if someone would put his bike on the back of a pickup truck and take him home instead of having to. It took him 2 hours to get here, by the way. That's a long way from Rancho Cordova to Roseville. That's dedication. That's wanting to be at church. Amen? And he needs a ride every week, actually, you know. But you know, I know it's somewhat difficult for us to get it together. This morning we're in John chapter 10, not for him to get it together, but for us to get it together to make that commitment to give someone a ride to church who needs one. John chapter 10 this morning. If you don't have a Bible, raise your hand, and we'll get a Bible to you so you can read along with us. Everyone have a Bible? Okay, what about New King James Bible? Everyone have a New King James Bible? That's the translation we're working out of. Okay, great, wonderful. Last week, we looked at the Good Shepherd. We looked at the sheepfold. We looked at the gatekeeper. We looked at hearing Jesus' voice. We looked at not only listening, but then doing the will of the Father, doing the will of the Son and the Holy Spirit. And we renewed our thoughts on how we are the sheep and how Jesus keeps us in the sheepfold and protects us. The Joneses were coming back from a vacation, and some guy on the other side of the highway passes three cars, and there's no room for him. He's coming down on them, and it's a two-lane, and he has no place to go, and they're heading for a head-on collision at high speed on the freeway. And the Joneses, at the last second, they swerved off and went off to the side of the road and hit the gravel and lost control of their car, and the hand of God came down and magnetized that car to earth, and they were saved. And that's God. That's us in the sheepfold. That's us being blessed. That's us being protected. That's us knowing that the Father is watching, that the Father and Son are with us, and that we can know that we know that we know and not have to worry or have to fret or have to stress out about it. That whatever's going on in our life, sometimes what's going on we think is good and it's not really good in the Father's eyes. Sometimes we think what's going on is bad and it's actually good in the Father's eyes. You know, that's just how it is. Sometimes, you know, one day we were totally out of control here. I mean, everything was just like messed up and not working and too many things happening at one time. And I prayed, Lord, let us get this under control. And then it got under control. And I said, oh, finally, 3 o'clock, we got it under control. And then the Lord spoke and he said, yeah, well, you think you do. That's an illusion. Because, you know, he's got it under control. And even when we think we got it back under control, it doesn't mean it's under control, except that it's under his control. But it may not be what we want. Well, here in chapter 10 of John, a lot of stuff going on. Now, it was the Feast of Dedication in Jerusalem, and it was winter. And Jesus walked in the temple in Solomon's porch. Then the Jews surrounded him and said to him, how long do you keep us in doubt? Oy vey, how long do you keep us in doubt, Jesus? If you are the Christ, tell us plainly. Now, hasn't he been telling them plainly for chapters here in John? Yeah. Jesus answered them, I told you, and you do not believe. It's not that he didn't tell, it's that they won't believe, and so they keep coming back at him. The works that I do in my Father's name, they bear witness of me, but you do not believe, because you are not of my sheep, as I said to you. Now, last week we looked at the sheepfold with the one door, one opening, one gate, and how the good shepherds at night would sleep in that opening so the wolves couldn't get in, the bad guys, the thieves couldn't get in, so that the sheep couldn't wander off. Well, you're not my sheep, as I said to you. My sheep hear my voice. Last week we looked at hearing his voice and how the owner of the sheep would come and at night he'd bring the sheep in and the sheep would reside in a communal sheepfold, but then in the morning, the owner would come and the gatekeeper would allow the owner to call out for his sheep. And he'd say, come on, guys, come on. And they'd recognize his voice and they would follow him, but they would not follow a stranger's voice because they did not know that voice. They knew that if they followed the familiar voice, that then they would be led to the pastures and they'd eat. And it'd be wonderful out there in the green pastures with the sun and the food. Like us. If we know his voice, John 10:10, what kind of life does God offer? Abundant life. Not just good, but abundant is what he wants for us. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, so the Father giving us to Jesus, is greater than all. And no one, in the Greek, this means no one, is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one. Then the Jews took up stones again to stone him. They were always trying to stone Jesus. And Jesus answered them, many good works I have shown you from my Father. For which one of those works do you stone me? For healing the blind man? Which one? And the Jews answered him, saying, for a good work we do not stone you, but for blasphemy, and because you, being a man, make yourself God. And Jesus answered them with a question, is it not written in your law, I said, you are gods? If he called them gods, to whom the word of God came, and the scriptures cannot be broken, do you say of him whom the Father sanctified and sent into the world, you are blaspheming, because I said I am the Son of God? If I do not do the works of my Father, do not believe me. But if I do, though you do not believe me, believe the works, the miracles, the signs, the wonders, that you may know and believe that the Father is in me and I in him. Therefore they sought again to seize him, but he escaped out of their hand. And he went away again beyond the Jordan to the place where John was baptizing at first, and there he stayed. Then many came to him and said, John performed no sign. John the Baptist. John, not John the writer of the gospel, but John the Baptist, performed no sign, but all the things that John spoke about this man were true, and many believed in him. Last week, we took a walk through the first half of John chapter 10, the first 21 verses. If you weren't here, you can go on YouTube and watch it. You can get the CD. You can listen to it on our website. The good shepherd and the sheep was the message. The first 21 verses of John chapter 10 took place during the Feast of Tabernacles, also sometime referred to as the Feast of Booths. It was an annual feast, and it was celebrated in commemoration of the time God provided for his people as they wandered in the desert for 40 years. Now, when you stand on Mount Moab, which Jim Furby and Cheryl Furby and me, we've all stood there on Mount Moab where Moses stood, and you look down into the valley, it's hard to imagine. I mean, it's a great valley. It's a grand valley. It's a vast valley. But it's hard to imagine how they could have wandered for so many years without getting out of that valley. Well, you know, sometimes someone comes along and I hear their story and it's the same old story over and over again. Oh, I've got this, I've got that. Oh, this is happening, that's happening. This person has done this to me, that person has done that to me. And, you know, it's like wandering. You know, it's like, come on. You know, it's been 3 years, and you come in, or I talk to you on the phone, or I see you on Sunday, and for 3 years, you keep telling the same story over and over again. Wandering in the wilderness, not getting the picture, not getting the John 10:10 part of John 10:10, but getting the other part of John 10:10. What does the devil do? Comes to destroy, to steal, and to kill you, to kill your spiritual life. And when you're stuck in a rut, and what's a rut? A rut is a grave with two sides instead of four. That's all. And wandering in the desert, endlessly wandering. Well, that's what was happening at that point with the tribe of Israel when they wandered. Maybe, you know, when I look at that valley below, I'm thinking, well, maybe 3 years. But, you know, that'd be tough. Maybe, okay, let's push it 5 years. But, you know, but then again, in our own lives, how much time do we spend fumbling around, blundering through life, wandering aimlessly in life without getting anywhere? Unfocused, unfulfilled, constantly being unglued. You know, some people, it's, oh no, man, the sky, you know, it's falling down. And you know, that's what they talk about, how everything, That's not John 10:10. That's desert living. Fumbling, unfocused, unfulfilled, unglued, searching, wanting, looking for something, and never finding it. 5 years goes by, 10 years goes by, 15 years. And then you go to the Christian bookstore, and then there's 100 books that you can read or more. You go on Amazon, there's 1,000 self-help, Christian self-help books. And so you can spend 5 years just reading the books of how to get out of it, or 10 years reading the books, because then new books are written. Oh, how do I escape this rut I'm in? How do I get to John 10:10, abundant living, wandering in the wilderness? It's a common experience for all men and women. Like the nation of Israel, each of us has our own wilderness experience, and you know what? It's part of life. But it should not be a long part of life. We know we have the promise, and we're on our way, but where is it experientially? Where are we getting it? Wandering, wondering in what seems to be wasted time in the wilderness life. But God made his hand known during those wanderings. What did they have? What sign, what did God give them during those wanderings? Huh? Manna from heaven. Cloud, a Shekinah glory cloud. And fire, fire from heaven. Pillar of fire. And water, yeah, water from a rock. He taught them that he provided for them, that they were not alone. And so first you find yourself wandering in life and lost and not connected. And then you start calling out to God because you're in the desert and you're thirsty and you're hungry. And not necessarily for water or for food, but spiritually. And then what do? Finally, you give in and you start saying, I'm going to pray. I do this. Lord Jesus, throw me a bone. Let me know that you're here. Let me know that you care. Let me know that you're watching and I can count on you. You listen and hear. And then, like, the fourth thing that happens is he answers. And your prayer's answered, and then you're renewed, and you have faith, hope, and love again on an experiential level. We also must experience God's hand coming down on our lives, as well as acknowledging his existence, as well as knowing that he speaks to us through his word, through saints, that he cares about us. We have to know that God's hand is upon us. We don't like wandering, but it's part of the Christian experience. It's what gets us calling for the Good Shepherd. When the sheep is lost out there, it starts to And not only does the sheep know the shepherd's voice, but the shepherd knows the sheep's voice. And so when the sheep starts lost, wandering, afraid. Well, then the shepherd hears, and then the shepherd calls out to the sheep. And then the two of them, they start closing the gap. The sheep starts heading for the shepherd, and the shepherd starts heading for the sheep. And that's how it works. It's quite simple. But yet we neglect to take it into our lives. Cry out. Listen. The second half of John chapter 10, verses 22 through 42, take place during the Feast of Dedication, which is about 2 months after the Feast of the Tabernacles and the events of chapter 8, 9, and 10, the first half of 10. The Feast of Dedication is commonly called Hanukkah. Yeah. Yeah, Jews celebrate Hanukkah today. How many of you have ever been to a Hanukkah celebration? Okay, yeah. Now, what they do today is they kind of combine it, because Hanukkah originally The Feast of Dedication originally took place sometime like on the 25th of a month, and it may have been November, it may have been December. What they do today, though, is because they miss out on Christmas gifts, they connect it with Christmas, and they give gifts. And so it works really well today for them to have this connection. But the short of Hanukkah is, it's a feast commemorating the rededication of the Holy Temple in Jerusalem. The second temple in Jerusalem. Now, this rededication of the temple took place at the time of the Maccabean Revolt. How many of you have heard of the Maccabean brothers? Okay, 30%. Now, they revolted against, once again, Israel, the nation, finds itself in captivity. And this time, it's the Seleucid, this Greco-Syrian empire of the 2nd century B.C., and it's ruled by a guy who's a terrible guy, a really bad guy, a bad ruler. And he's treating the Jews terribly, really bad. I mean, he's digging deep into his bag of tricks and weapons and torture to get at them. Now, Hanukkah is observed for 8 days and nights, starting on the 25th day of Kislev, according to the Hebrew calendar. Now, don't forget, there are different calendars. There's a Chinese calendar, which some people still follow. There's a Hebrew calendar, and there's our calendar. Now, it may occur any time from late November to late December in our calendar. Now, contemporary Jews celebrate around Christmas, as I said. Now, it was a feast birthed in commemorating an historical event. Now, many of the feasts were dictated by God, in the Word, in the Torah, observe this, observe that. But the Feast of Hanukkah, the Feast of Dedication, came about because of an event that took place in the history of Israel. And this thing took place in the 400 years of silence. When did the 400 years of silence take place? Between the last book of the Old Testament, which is Malachi, and the first book of the New Testament, which is... Okay, and there were 400 years of silence. And what does that mean, 400 years of silence? Well, it means that they didn't hear from God. There were no angelic appearances, no angels recorded, no messengers from God, no miracles that they saw, no prophets, no prophecies telling what would come, except the old prophecies that already existed, and essentially no fresh revelation, no fresh word from God. From the end of the Old Testament until John the Baptist appeared on the scene in the New Testament, there had been silence. Now, in 165 BC, the Maccabee family comes on the scene, and they defeated the bad king, Antiochus Epiphanes. Greco-Syrian king, who ruled most of the Mideast at that point, most of it. And Israel was one of the nations under his cruel power. This evil king forced the Jews to abandon the worship of their father, Jehovah, by defiling the temple in Jerusalem and outlawing Judaism, outlawing worshiping Jehovah, outlawing the assembly of the Jews together. Just made it, you can't, I'm going to decimate, I'm going to stamp out your religion and your ability to practice it. And Antiochus was the king who had the pig sacrificed on the altar in Jerusalem. To the Jews, porkers, pigs were filthy, disgusting animals that you didn't even come near. If you got a smudge of pig blood on you, or a drop of pig blood on you, you were defiled, and you had to go and do the ceremonial cleansing, and you certainly couldn't eat it. It wasn't not just kosher, it was against God's law, the Mosaic law. It was against the Old Testament. It was against all the rules and regulations, Deuteronomy, Leviticus. You don't eat pig. It's just not for Jews. That's for the filthy Gentiles, to make them filthier. That was their thought. And so laying a pig on the temple altar and sacrificing and smearing its blood everywhere. Imagine if we had a pig here and someone comes in while we're all sleeping last night and takes the pig and slaughters it and then takes the blood and just smears it everywhere. That's what it was like. Blood on everything is nasty enough, but to the Jews, pig's blood wasn't just a physical obscenity, but a spiritual biohazard. It was like, you know, you can't touch a dead person. That was part of the Nazarene vow and whatnot, different things that they had, but pig was just horrible, defiled, and the holy temple was defiled. They had to close the building. We'd have to close the building. We'd have to call in the hazmat people. We'd have to call the hazmat people in to do a cleanup. And not only did the heathen ruler defy the temple, but he passed laws making it illegal for the Jews to worship their God or to read the Torah. To even read the Old Testament was against the law and had severe penalties. And not only that, but insult upon injury, he forced them to worship the Greek gods instead. And so it was a bad time for Israel, for the people. No place for Jewish worship, forbidden by law to worship. And they're thinking, has God forsaken us? There's been all these years, hundreds of years of silence. Have you ever felt that way? Have you ever felt like God is being silent? That he's not talking, that he's not directing, that he's not providing? And where is God? What in my life? Where is he? How could he let these things happen? Or maybe it's not even trials and tribulations and things happening. It's just this terribly dry desert period in your life where there's no, like, you know, Holy Spirit, no Holy Spirit goosebumps, no reading the word and having something jump out at you and saying, praise the Lord. No praying and having an answer to prayer. And you wonder and you wonder and you wonder. You feel unworthy. Have I no place to go and meet God? I can't connect with God. Has he forgotten me? Maybe it's sin in my life that's defiled me. You know, sometimes that's what we think. We think, oh man, well, it's that sin, whatever it may be. And sometimes it is. Sometimes the sin does defile. And sin doesn't make God run from you, but you're running from God, especially with besetting sin, sin that's constantly in your life. And you're not going to have, you know, if you're spending all of your time watching some stupid program on TV, you're not going to have your spiritual antennae up because you've got the TV antennae instead. And so what are you expecting? You get the audio Bible on there and you listen for 20 minutes, the audio Bible. If you want to listen to that, it's a wonderful thing, audiobible.com. It's a 99-cent app, and it's just a really wonderful devotional, go through the Bible in a year deal that you can do. And you listen, and then, hello, what happened? I feel so different. Well, hello, heard the word, meditated on the word, and things change. The way it works is that just when you think God has forgotten you, forsaken you, is done with you, well, then in desperation you pray, you read the word, and God answers and does something in your life. Works for me. How many of you does that work for? It works. It's like soap. You know, I get my hands greasy from working on a car. I go to the sink with water, and I get some lava. How many of you know what lava is? Okay, lava is this soap that has lava in it for greasy hands. And I wash my hands with that soap and that lava water, and my hands get cleaner. Well, that's how it works. All the time. I pray, ask for repentance. Lord, don't have anything blocking your pouring into me and pouring out of me, Lord. I don't want any sin blocks. I don't want anything in my life that just keeps me from you, where I'm turning my back on you. I don't want to be the prodigal. I want to be your son, and I want you to be able to John 10:10 me. Give me that life abundantly, not just for myself, not for my pleasures, not for my lusts, not for my greed, but that I might continue to bless others. Lord, give me more life so that I can bless people. I can serve people. I can share you with people. Because you see, there's the miracles, but guess what about John the Baptist? What did it say about John the Baptist? No, he didn't do anything. I mean, he did, but he never did a miracle. He didn't perform any signs or wonders. But the Bible refers to John as the greatest person on earth. But what did he do? He prepared the way and he evangelized. He prophesied evangelism. The Lord is coming. He's coming. He'll be here. For Israel, it was that time, the time between the Old Testament and Matthew, that the Maccabean brothers, the father and the sons, come on the scene. The father passed and the sons kept on. And they were called by God to deliver the nation of Israel. Judah Maccabee and his brothers raised an army of guerrilla freedom fighters. They say probably about 10,000, which was puny compared to the enemy, the Greco-Syrian Empire, the Seleucid Empire. But they were godly men. And they were not only strong and sincere in their faith and their mission to reclaim Israel, to rededicate the temple, to reinstall, to throw all the idols out of the country, all of the heathen worship, and bring back the Word of God, bring back the temple where God could be worshiped. But godly, sincere men, the army of God, like David with Goliath, they wanted to reinstall what Israel once had, to throw off their oppressors. And God gave them the victory, and they defeated the foe, the forces of the Greco-Syrians based in Syria, the Seleucids. And after the brothers gained control of Jerusalem, they weren't like politicians. They were like generals. And they went out throughout the country, throughout the villages, throughout the cities, and they destroyed the idols. They destroyed the places of worship. And by now, guess where the heathens are worshiping? In the temple. They've taken over the temple. But all traces of idolatry were eliminated by these brothers. And then after this war is won, a physical war, something that you could say, well, my men, we lost 2,000 men in this battle, these wars, and we fought hard and we prevailed. And you could maybe lose sight of the fact that God was there even in war, calling them, leading them, having them win the fight. And you could start saying, oh, well, we did it. The army did it. The guerrilla warfare was the secret. Then along come the priests to cleanse the temple of idolatry and of all the blood and all of that Antiochus had done, because even though it had been cleaned up for the heathen to be able to use the temple, it was still there. And there were procedures that the priests had to perform, a ceremonial cleansing ceremony. And they had won the war, and I'm sure they gave thanks to God, but it was a military victory. It was all looking good until it came to a crucial step in the temple. An important element of temple cleansing involved burning sanctified olive oil in the temple's menorah for a period of 8 days. Now, this is a tourist menorah. You go to Israel and they sell these to the tourists. But a menorah, basically a lampstand, originally in the temple, the lampstand was a tall standalone model. And that one had been taken and melted because it had been solid gold. Now that they say the Jews have another one they're creating for the new temple that's of solid gold. But the thing was, part of this ceremonial cleansing procedure was to burn oil for 8 days. And lo and behold, there's a problem. And the problem is that the oil had to be sanctified oil, oil with the priest's seal on it, and there wasn't enough oil but for one day. And this was a big problem, because how do you go out and find oil? It's all specially prepared. There's a whole procedure for the oil. And so, no oil. How do we rededicate? How do we cleanse? How do we take care of this? Well, guess what happened? Miraculously, the oil. They lit, in faith, they lit the candles, or they lit the oil, they lit the menorah, and in faith, because it would have been just oil burning with a wick, and in faith, it burned for 8 days. And so there was God. Yeah, you guys, you got the army together, Maccabean brothers, 10,000 strong. You revolted. Many lost their lives in the fight, and you won. But you still needed me for the cleansing. And I was there. And that oil burned for 8 days. Now, Solomon's porch, mentioned in verse 2, was on the east side of the temple, and it was a part of the original temple that had survived the destruction of the Babylonians. It was also called the Porch of Judgment. If you look in your insert, you'll find a picture of it. Can we have the picture, please? It was a massive building restored by another king named Herod. And it was huge. It was a huge hall with rooms where the priests resided. It was a gathering place where all the religious leaders and people would come. And the religious people would answer the questions of the Jews. And it was the ideal place for Jesus to come. Teachers would be in between the columns teaching and different teachers, and this was a place. Jesus loved to come to the temple to teach. The people were gathered there. They were thirsty there. They were wanting spiritual teaching. Like when people come on Sunday morning, what do you want? Well, you want to hear something that's in the Word, some spiritual teaching. This made it an ideal location for Jesus to speak to the people. And Jesus will always find that place in your life where he can speak to you. Upon seeing Jesus on the porch somewhere, the people gathered around him. They surrounded him. Are you the Messiah, the Christ, our deliverer? In the original language, it means hemmed him in. They just got him there, and they want the answer. But Jesus made himself available. He was there during the feast. John 10, verses 25 through 26, Jesus answered them, I told you, and you do not believe the works that I do in my Father's name. They bear witness of me, but you do not believe because you are not of my sheep, as I said to you. John records that Jesus had over and over again answered their question. And John 7, John 8, he had answered their question in various verses. He had identified himself as coming from the Father, doing the Father's will, being the light of the world, being the bread, the good shepherd. He reminded them of the miracles that he had provided, proved beyond any question that he had the power of God to heal the blind, to heal the lepers, to all kinds of things, to forgive sin. But they didn't want to believe him. They believed in his miracles, but they questioned, where did they come from? The devil or from heaven? Some said the devil, Jesus demonized. Others said, how can that be? Why would a demon do something good? Why would the devil do something good? And Jesus explained that they were not his sheep, and the evidence was they would not follow him and believe his word. In Jesus' next statement, he absolutely declares once again his deity, his oneness, and his equality with God the Father. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me, and I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Get this. You're his sheep, you shall never perish. Neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all. No one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one. Most assuredly, he's saying, amen, without a doubt. I answer your question. My sheep hear my voice, not just the audible sound either, but they hear with their hearts and they believe and they follow. They hear, they get it, and they follow. Because of their hearing being in faith. And he states that he gives them eternal life that no one can take away. No one. He could have made it more complicated, but instead he made it so that it couldn't be clearer. Accept me, have eternal life. No one can take it from you. He proclaimed his authority to give eternal life, and he said it comes from the Father. And those that believe the Father should believe me. The doctrine of eternal security of the believer is undoubtedly, unquestionably, indisputably confirmed in that Jesus repeats that the Father is greater than all. Through him, a guarantee of heavenly inheritance is for us. And are we perfect? Do we sin? Of certainly we do. But then we repent and we're forgiven. He's all powerful. Our sins are forgiven. Past sins are forgiven. You can look back. I look back in my life and I go, oh man, some of the things I did before I was a Christian and some of the things I did after I was a Christian. But I'm forgiven. Things that I do now, I'm forgiven. Things that I do in the future are forgiven. Doesn't mean I just go out and do them. Oh, I'm forgiven. No. But it means that I know that I'm his. And I can't be snatched away. And that gives me faith, that gives me hope, that gives me motivation, that invigorates me, restores me, makes me alive so that I can fight the evil, starting with the evil right here and then going for the evil out there. And Peter, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled and that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. And they ask, he answers, then the Jews took up stones again to stone him. They ask, and he answers, and then the Jews took up stones. Sometimes people just want to fight. They want to argue. That's all there is to it. There's a lot of people. There's Christians like that. I remember one time we had this joker in the church, this guy in the church who just talked about his Christianity constantly. He had a business, and he'd be in my office, and he'd call someone or someone would call him and he'd say, I'm in my pastor's office. And the guy in the other line, you know, Christian probably, said, oh, he's in his pastor's office. The guy was a con man. We'd go out and I get calls from the community. This guy goes to your church and he ripped us off. But he used his Christianity for a ripoff, for conning. And then he brought this guy with him one time. I think it was to a picnic, if I recall. And this guy was a blasphemer. He just would mock Jesus. And he got to some of the brothers, and he got to one brother in particular who physically started to go at him. It was going to knock his lights out, punch him out. And we had to hold the brother back, and the brother could do it. But this guy was just, yeah, go, do it, you know, baiting him. He got under his skin, under the Christian skin, because he was mocking our Lord Jesus, saying horrible things about Jesus. Some people just want to fight. They're contentious. Well, the Pharisees, they like to be contentious. They just want to fight with Jesus all the time. Jesus answered them, many good works I have shown you from the Father, from my Father. For which of those works do you stone me? The Jews answered, saying, for a good work we do not stone you, but for blasphemy, and because you, being a man, make yourself God. They understood the importance of his statement, and it infuriated them that he said he was God. And they took up stones once again to kill him. They wanted a plain answer. Jesus complied, and they get the stones. Jesus, in his defense, asked them which of the good works he had done would give them cause, and it was a rhetorical question. He knew they just wanted to kill him, but he asks for their benefit. And to this day, many people will acknowledge Jesus as a teacher, a prophet, a healer, but they choke on the God part. Well, if he's such a good teacher, then he's a liar? How can a good teacher be a liar? He said, I am. It's me. Jesus answered them, it is not written in your law. I said, you are gods. Is it not written in your law? I want to say it's not written in your law, but Jesus answered them, is it not written in your law? I said, you are gods. If he called them gods to whom the word of God came and the scripture cannot be broken, do you say of him whom the Father sanctified and sent into the world, you are blaspheming because I said I am the Son of God? What's this? They are gods, the Pharisees and the scribes. He says, wasn't it written that you are gods? Well, he's quoting Psalm 82, verse 6. I have said you are gods and all of your children of the Most High. And all of you children of the Most High. He's actually saying you're like gods, because in that day, if you were a judge and they judged all the time, you functioned like God. But big notation, the word God is what case? That lowercase. Yeah, it's not God. It's, you know, a type, a judge, someone who stands over other people and decides their fate. You get 20 years in prison. You die like a god. You go free. Oh, praise God. Lower G. Jesus was saying that he was only relating to them what the law stated. Psalm 82, 6, Old Testament, where judges were called gods because they held the power of life and death in their hands. Doesn't Scripture say you are gods? Asked Jesus. Why then are you so upset when I say I am the Son of God? He throws them a curveball that they can't hit. He implies that the Pharisees and scribes cannot break their own law. And Jesus was in truth in the Father's will. And you guys can't break your own law. And furthermore, to do so would make them lawbreakers and not lawkeepers. And they, you know, they just prided in being lawkeepers. In John 10:18, Jesus will say what he taught was at the commandment of the Father. It's not John 10:18. That's a wrong scripture. I don't remember which scripture it is. You can look it up. In verse 37, if I do not do the works of my Father, do not believe me. But if I do, though you do not believe me, believe the works, that you may know and believe that the Father is in me and I in him. He's telling them, if what he said is untrue, they prove it. But it's true. And he puts them on the spot. You can't say that I'm not of the Father. The Father set me apart. The Father sent me into the world. And the proof is, the proof that he sent me into the world is that I'm sanctified. I'm set apart by the Father. And I perform miracles in the Father's name and the Father's will. It's a clear statement. If he hadn't completed the works of the Father, well, then don't believe me. But he did. And this morning, believe him. He completed all the prophecies, except for the temple being rebuilt in Jerusalem. But otherwise, 800 or so prophecies, messianic prophecies, have come true. He did miracles. He forgives our sins. He answers our prayers. He is God. He's in the Father. He is deity, one with the Father in him, the two being one, and then the Holy Spirit, the three being one, three persons, but one. The miracles that he did were signs that he established, signs that established him as being genuine. The miracles were done, verse 38, so they would know. Last week, we saw other pretenders that had come along, different ones claiming to be the Messiah, but they didn't have the signs and wonders. And they were rejected. Matthew 21:21-22. Sometimes we can grow discouraged, disappointed that we don't see more miracles in our life, more things happening. In Luke 4:40, you know, you can move mountains, and we say, well, I'm not moving mountains. What's with this? Jesus said the greatest prophet born in the history of the world was a man who did no miracle. None, John the Baptist. But what did he do? He proclaimed the word of God. And that's what we're to do. We're to proclaim the word of God. Therefore, they sought again to seize him, but he escaped out of their hands. Sometimes when I read these verses about Jesus, it confuses me. I get a check in my spirit, if you will. Like John 8:59, then they took up stones to throw at him, but Jesus hid himself and went out of the temple. Jesus hid from the Pharisees? Why would he hide? Going through the midst of them and so passed by. Well, it's hard for me sometimes to come to terms with this. They sought to seize him, but he escaped out of their hand. Why didn't he just whack him? Or say, back off or else. And he went away again beyond the Jordan to the place where John was baptizing at first, and there he stayed. Then many came to him and said, John performed no sign, but all the things that John spoke about this man were true. And many believed in him there. What's the priority of ministry? Doing exactly what John did. Talking about Jesus, pointing people to Jesus, leading people to Jesus, exalting Jesus. Matthew 11:11, assuredly I say to you, among those born of woman, there has not risen one greater than John the Baptist. The evangelist, it's a question, a rhetorical question, but it's an answer as well. But he who is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. We have that power to change lives, to turn everything around for someone. Someone came to me and shared the gospel with me, and it totally turned my life upside down and changed my life. I was an agent for the devil. I was the devil's man 100%. And the word, the sharing, turned me around. So I gave my life to Jesus. Although the Lord had legally declared and upheld his claims that the power he had in doing miracles were unmistakably from the Father, the Jews were not persuaded, and they sought to arrest him. But he escaped them and traveled east. Actually, it says he passed through them. And for me, I don't know, don't build doctrine on this, but for me, that escaped him, them escaped, passed through them. I think he just kind of, like they were all there and they're ready to kill him and they're ready to jump him and whatnot. And I think he just, you know. Won't be seeing you guys in hell unless you make a big change. And he goes to a place, a beautiful place, past the Jordan, a place we looked at in chapters past where John was baptizing. A place of peace, of rest. This morning, do you have abundant life? The John 10:10. Yeah, you do. Does it always feel like you do? No. But the word says we do. It's there at all times, but we need to tap into it. How do we tap into it? Pray, be in God's word. Huh? Serve. Yeah. You see, faith without works is dead. And it's not just, you know, for me. It's not for me to listen to audio Bible or for me to go on Right Media and enjoy all these incredible teachings. You know, I did that in Bible college. Every day, you know, sponge. Just getting taught, getting fed. But then there comes the time. Now, when I graduated, if I had just, you know, said, oh, well, you know what? I think I'll sign up for another 8 years. Could have. I'm not saying that I wouldn't have gotten something out of it that of value. But, man, we were ready. All of us. My whole class, we were ready. We were chomping at the bit. We wanted to go out. Now, we went out, and a lot of us got whacked and whatnot, but, you know, we went out, and we learned, and we shared, and over time, one guy became, Bill Prevett became head of missions for all of Asia, for Assemblies of God, the entire Asia. Another guy became this incredible evangelist in Japan. Other guys became, there were multiple guys who became pastors, and Healdsburg, California, and just all over different places. But we went out. We were taught and we fed, got fed and we learned all this stuff and whatnot, but then we went out and we shared. But first, you have to know the shepherd's voice. You have to be a sheep. This morning, do you hear his calling? Well, okay, you hear the voice, but what place does it have in your life? Are you in the sheepfold and saying, oh, I like it in the sheepfold. It's, you know, it's, I'm protected. It's neat. It's cool. I don't have to worry about the wolves getting me. I don't have to worry about the thieves stealing me. I'm in that sheepfold with the other sheep, cozy, warm, if it's cold. Or do you get out and go? Sharing, touching lives, changing lives. If you don't know Jesus this morning, well, then this is all nothing. It's a bunch of hot air. It's a bunch of waste. And if you don't know Jesus, well, and the Holy Spirit's nudging you, the Holy Spirit's got his little dagger and he's kind of sticking you with it a little bit. Or maybe it's the sword of God and God's sword has just cut you right in half. And you realize, man, I'm not serving God. I'm not even listening to God. I'm not acknowledging God. Well, then I can tell you, your life cannot be in order. Your life must be a mess. And so give your life to God this morning. How do you do that? Well, right now, ask for forgiveness. Repent of your sins and ask him into your life. Talk to someone you came with. Come to me after service. Come to anyone pretty much in this room and talk with them, share with them. I want God. And if you are separated, you're one of his sheep, but you just haven't been the best of a sheep lately. You've kind of been more of a pig than a sheep. Well, more of a prodigal son than God's son. Well, change it. Get in the Word. The Word will convict you. Get in prayer. Prayer will bolster your spiritual strength. It'll get you back on the compass, reading the right path. Make a decision. You know what? I've been doing this. It's not right. I know it's not right. And I'm going to quit doing it. And see how God meets you where you're at. See, this church, Calvary Chapel, Roseville, we're a meet you at church. Meet you where you're at, church. We love you that way, but then we love you too much to leave you that way, and that's God. We're going to meet you at church with a come as you are God. And then God takes us, and he John 10 tends us. Lord God, we come before you this morning, and Father God, we've heard the word. And the word is alive. It's true. It's a sword that cuts away the bad stuff. And leaves the good, and then the good thrives, it flourishes, it grows. And Lord, this morning, let us be your sheep. How many sheep are here? Say bah. No. Yeah, you know what? I had a hard time calling myself a sheep when I became a Christian. I did. It was right along with having a hard time when I wrote something, putting a capital uppercase H for he or uppercase G for God. I had a hard time with that. And a sheep, I'm no sheep. No way. I'm a bull. But now, you know, I'm a sheep and thankful for it. Maybe you're having a hard time being a sheep and you're just bullheaded. Lord, let us be sheep, and let us appreciate what comes with that. Doesn't mean you're stupid or something. Just means we're yours, we're your children, children of God, with a full inheritance, with the glory of that. And Lord, let us know that when we stand up and walk, when we go through our week, let us not be weak in those things of you. Let us be Beatitudes week, where we're humble, but we know that we know that we know that we're your children, children of promise. And we go out there and we do what we're called to do. We pray this in your precious name, Jesus. Amen. All right, Christian soldiers. Christian soldiers. That's what we are. But we're also Christian.